Welcome everyone, sorry for the delay. My name is Giorgio, I'm here to tell you some stuff about these microservices you keep hearing about on Twitter and other social networks. So, let's start with who I am. Giorgio Sironi, I work in Italy on a payment system named OneBip. I'm a developer, like most of the people in this room, I think. My interests are object-oriented programming and automated testing, but in the last 2 years, I've taken another road, that of distributed systems, because at OneBip, we started dividing the responsibilities of a single payment into multiple services. What do I mean by that? We all know about monolithic PHP applications. Who of you was at the talk of Joe this morning? Okay, so some of you already heard a bit of this stuff. And basically, you don't have to deal with all the responsibilities of your application into a single process in Apache talking to a single database. You can also divide responsibilities into multiple services that collaborate in order to accomplish some goal. In our case, that goal is to transfer some funds from the SIM card of a user, so from his the credit loaded on his prepaid card, his phone, and transfer this money to a particular merchant using our system. And the user receives a digital or physical good in exchange for this money. So we are like a PayPal of the PayPal of prepaid SIMs. So in order to deal with a single payment, multiple PHP applications work with each other. We have a core application, which is the one registering transactions, storing the balances of the accounts of the users. We have a connectivity service, which deals with all the proprietary protocols of mobile phone operators. Vodafone talks one language, while Telia Sonera talks another, and so on. We connect with hundreds of operators, and you have to abstract away that all the differences that they have, the connectivity services deal with it. And we have also a subscription engine, which is a service oriented to dealing with recurring payments. One of our business models is a single purchase. You pay once for purchasing something. And another business model is the subscription, where you pay once a week or once a month in order to continue being able to access a service. These are only a few of our internal microservices. I always tell people they're not micro enough. And they communicate with each other with HTTP requests, basically. We'll see a bit of how that works inside this talk. So I talk about distributed applications, but you're probably already distributing your applications in an horizontal way. Your PHP front-end runs on several machines. Usually one machine is not enough. You have to distribute on some of them. Your database is commonly placed on another machine in the same local network, maybe with a secondary database to act as a backup even in the same network. And if you execute JavaScript code in your applications, this JavaScript code is shipped to the machine of the user, which is several hundreds or thousand kilometers from yourself. So you're already distributing the work that your application does over multiple machines and possibly multiple countries. The kind of distribution I'm talking about today instead is vertical, not horizontal. So you can have multiple services that collaborate with each other, each with its own PHP code base, or even other languages, as Joe suggested this morning. Each with its own database, so that they don't share a common point of integration like MySQL tables. So again, if you're able to use different languages for your services, you can also use different databases and different clients. While an application can expose a JavaScript client that is shipped to users and that runs in their browsers, other applications can have clients that are only other PHP services. However, if you divide your applications into vertical services like this, you need still to make them communicate. And we've chosen HTTP for them to communicate, and It is a quite known protocol, easy for web developers to introspect and to write requests in. That's why we want to use it not only for our front end, but also for making our services talk. So, distributing along horizontal lines is pretty well known. You do it just for the load and for separating your databases so that you can tailor machines to different things that they have to do. But there are some advantages also to this vertical distribution. One, for example, is the code segregation that you get from splitting up a monolith into multiple services. When you're building a single application for all of your needs, it can become a big ball of mud where each class has dependencies on the rest of the system. When you're splitting along services lines, you are forced not to depend on classes that are in different services. This is because services may not share code, if not for libraries that you can extract and install with Composer or with PL or with your preferred package management system. Also, if the services are in different languages, it's pretty obvious that they cannot share code. So you get, instead of a big monolith where there are dependencies everywhere, at least some strict ways where code cannot depend on other code because services are deployed independently. Also, it becomes pretty easy to spot scalability problems, to see where your bottlenecks are. In the case of our three components that participate to a single payment, one day our subscription engine was having slowdowns and issues, and it affected a bit of our business models, but it was easy to spot that the problem was there because only the machines running that service were the one with the CPU going to 100%, or in other cases were the one with the RAM memory full. If you split along these lines, you also get some kind of isolation between failures. Since we have these two business models, purchase and subscription, and the subscription engine participate only to the subscription business model by doing the recurring billings each week or each month, when the subscription engine had some problems, only one of these business models was affected. So we continue make users pay for single purchases in several countries without issues. This kind of isolation is even more important if you split along the transactional part exposed to your end user and your reports part. So, for example, a panel where reports are shown to internal users may be down while users continue to pay and give you money to your application on other services. And given the kind of data processing that the panels do that may bring down applications for the load, it's very good to separate them so that a failure in one service leaves the other services unaffected. Splitting along services is also nice for the team partitioning that you need to get when you have more than three, four, five developers working on the same product. You don't want a single team of 15, 20 people working on the same code base because you will have lots of merge problems. A big learning curve where one developer is coming in has to learn a lot of the code base of hundreds of thousands of lines of code. If you split not only your application into services, but also your developers, your colleagues into different teams, each working on a different service, we get that when a new developer comes in, it can start by working on a single service. He has to learn a smaller code base, and you can optimize the communication of the developer working on the same service because they're all on the same table, they're just three or four. And you reduce instead the coupling and the communication between different services because developers talk with their colleagues that work on the same service and not with all the other people in the room. When Conway's law is a proverb, let's say, that says that we are bound to replicate the communication structures, the same communication structures between people and between our applications. So if you want to segregate your teams so that you can only learn some bit of a service, just a code base of 1,000, 10,000 lines of code instead of 100,000 lines of code, you can split along the services. And the new developers just has to learn a bit. So, distribution does not come for free. There are several problems that start coming up when you take a single PHP process, which was monolithic with this MySQL connection, let's say, and you start executing different bits of stuff on different machines in different code bases. One famous problem that also happened with the kind of horizontal distribution that we get between PHP and MySQL, for example, is latency. If you have chat interfaces between services that makes hundreds or thousands of calls to one another each second, you're going to get some latency problem. This is famous also in the distribution between PHP and MySQL because then you get the n plus one query problem. You have to show a list of entities, like a list of users, and the n plus one query problem is when you do a query to get the list of IDs, and then a single query for each of these users, each of these entities, in order to get their details. This is much slower than doing just a join and taking out all the data at the same time. The same goes for microservices. If I have two services communicate and I do n calls between them, each for showing a different row in a single view, I'm going to get a very slow application. So latency is something I have to deal with if I want to distribute. Another problem that is exacerbated when you start distributing into services is that of concurrency, because whereas first before you had only one application and the users making requests to it, now you have several different services in your local area network that talk to the same central services for example, for authentication. And if this request go on the same data, the same user row inside the database, concurrency is going to cause lost updates when someone writes and another service overwrites the changes. So latency and concurrency are pretty much very likely to come up when you start dividing into different databases. And the final biggest problem of dividing applications into services is that of partial failure. If you have a single PHP process that does everything, if you get an exception, you can just abort it, and the transaction will be rolled back, no problem. The user can restart a new request and possibly get some work done. If you get different databases into different services, another application may not respond at all. What do you do? You wait, you make a retrying process, you tell the error to the user. The other application may respond, but very slowly. So it may give you one row of result for a second for a very long time, so the users get a very light experience. It may be down for maintenance. There are many problems that can bring down just a single microservice, and it's not trivial that the other services can still work if one is down. If you want to get some isolation from these failures, you need to apply some patterns of distributed systems. Why would you want to do that? Because if you have lots of machines, lots of services, the probabilities of at least one of them being down or being slow at a certain moment become high up to the point where they reach one. So if you have dozens of machines, one of them is going to have problems. So you want to design the rest of the system in a way that when some machine has a problem, the other ones are not affected. There is a team at Google whose job is to change hard disks. And they work all day because when you have a big data center, hard disks are failing all the time. And however, you can see Google going down every time an hard disk and hard disk is replaced. So the rest of the application is able to do without one or more of the services. So, I talked about dividing responsibilities, but it's not enough to divide. You also have to make these applications, these independent services, collaborate with each other. Why? Because they share conceptually some data. They don't share a physical database, but for example, you want single sign-on on your front-end application for users and your back-end applications for your back-office, for your internal customers. In that case, they will need to share the same password, so a user can log in with the same password on one application or on the other. You need, in some way, to transport data between these services, and you need to do it as frequent as possible, so that when you change the password on one application, it is changed also on the other. And there are many styles of integration that have come up over the years. The simplest one is the file upload. You generate daily or hourly a big CSV file or XML file in an application, and a manual or automated process brings this file into the other service. This file is processed in some kind of background process, and then the databases of the different services are aligned. The biggest defect about this kind of integration is that it works in batches, so it's not very fast, since if you change your password on one application, then for you to be able to sign on another application, you will have to wait for the next batch. So it has a latency of hours, possibly less in case you do smaller files, but basically in high latency. So file upload was an option in the 90s, but for many applications today, it's not the case. Something that came up later was, we will just institute a shared database between our services, a MySQL table. All the services write on the same database and will always have the same data to work on. This was nice back in the days where the relational database was the god of the data in the world enterprise. So every application worked picking up data and writing data from the same database. But it sucks for other reasons. The changes are in real time, but there is no encapsulation whatsoever. So it's like communicating between objects by writing the public fields of a common object and hope for the best. You cannot do a schema change. If you do it, you have to deploy multiple versions of the applications with the renamed columns or the renamed tables. More or less, what happens in case you communicate between services by shared database is that people start to treat this database as the god, and you will never do a migration on that database again, because every time someone proposes a schema change, let's add some column, let's rename something, someone will say, yeah, well, but there is this other application of these people I don't talk with that are in another city, and we will have to notify them and tell them also to upgrade their code, to rename all these fields, and they take 5 weeks to deploy the application because they do it with a very slow pace, so let's just not do it. And you will remain with an outdated database that is constantly having an impedance mismatch with your application, because you can't rename everything. I mean, you want to refactor your code in order to face new challenges, new requirements, but if you can't refactor your database too, you have tired ends. So, shared database is faster than file uploads between different applications, but it sucks for other reasons, lack of encapsulation. So the next fashion, the next pad that came up was that of remote procedure calls. Basically, you have objects that represent other services which are remote, and when you call these objects, doing a normal method call like you will do on a local object, you will get that these calls are serialized, they transform it into EP packets, and sent via TCP or another communication protocol to another machine. The remote object will calculate something and returns your result over the wire, and for the programmer, it's like calling a local object. It doesn't know that that object is remote and that its method parameters and the return values of these methods were serialized and sent over an IP network in order for the call to complete. This at least provides a bit of encapsulation with respect to the shared database. If you want to change your local database, you can. It's just a question of leaving the interface, the method calls, not changed, leave it as they were. However, still, this has the requirement that services are always running and fast enough to give you a useful response at the same time. This is called temporal coupling. So if I have my panel which shows reports to the users of how much money we have made today, and my payment system where users can work, if the panel has some problems and I'm integrating between these two services with a remote procedure call, bringing down the panel will bring down also the payment system. So they're not decoupled as I want, because I want a panel that goes down because users continue to click and click and click and generate record, and my payment system instead to stay up and to continue making money. So to resolve the problem of the temporal coupling of remote procedure call, the next part, I hope it's here to stay, that came in is asynchronous messaging. So basically you take all these method calls between services and you make them asynchronous. So they do not return a result. They are void methods, to speak it in C or PHP language. What happens is that they are not method calls anymore, but they are messages sent from one application, from one service to another, without a result being returned immediately. This means that these messages can also be sent with some delay, since when the sending application has this message in a queue ready to be sent to another, it can go on with its work. It doesn't have to wait for it for the message to be delivered. The remote procedure call, if you want to consider a metaphor, is just making a phone call between people. You both have to be on the phone at the same time. I pick up the phone, I compose your number, you have to answer immediately. With asynchronous messaging instead, the metaphor is that of the post office. You send a letter or an email, if you want, if you're more technological. You send an email to someone, you don't have an immediate response. But this kind of integration works very well with respect to decoupling, because I can send you an email at 7 a.m. and you do not wake up because you have to answer my email. You will just deal with it when you receive it. And hopefully you will also send another email to me back with a useful result.
I got a question. What do you do when the processing of the message fails? Because you don't expect a result, so it's fire again. So what if it fails?
What do you do when processing of a message fails? Short answer now and possibly long answers after the talk. The short answer is I send an error message back to the sending application, which has a type that is different from the successful message. And this means that the sending application cannot show an immediate result to the user, because it still has to wait for it still has to wait for an error or a success message to come in, but still it's the user is waiting and not a process on a single web server. So the users may be annoyed by a lack of a response for a while, but your machines will stay up because they don't have to keep the Apache process open in order to wait for the other application to come up with a response. Longer answers after the talk, because this is a a very complex topic. So, what the topic, the main point of this talk is that you can use HTTP, which is a synchronous protocol, like a phone call. When you do an HTTP request, you need an immediate HTTP response. You can use it with some patterns in such a way inside the PHP services, so that you can transform it from a remote procedure call, a synchronous integration. You can transform it instead to messages, to an asynchronous style of integration where your requests do not block, let's say. And we see how to do it in a bit. But first, let's start by solving the simple problems of distributing PHP code phases, and then go on to the difficult problems instead, like latency and failures, and see how we can organize our HTTP requests so that we can still get the benefits of asynchronous messaging. The easy problems, for example, are authentication. We have different services deployed, possibly on different machines. How do we authenticate between them so that the users cannot call your panel services and serve fake calls? You can have a trusted environment, like a private LAN where that is not accessible from outside. That is easy enough when you start out. You can use HTTP headers for authentication. So if your PHP services talk with each other with an HTTP request, they add some headers that serve as an authentication. These headers can go from a static password, like with basic authentication, but also to more complex revocable authentication schemes, like adding a timestamp with the time at which the request was sent, plus a signature for that timestamp that proves that the sender was one of your services. You can have from simpler, like X authentication containing the password, from simpler headers to more complex one, depending on your requirements. But authentication between server to server calls is a solved problem. Another problem to solve is that of backward compatibility. Your services may be deployed independently, each has their own Apache. Maybe one application runs on Apache inside the machine, another runs inside Nginx on another different machines. If you deploy incompatible changes to the protocol that they use to communicate, like you rename a field in a request, you start to get some problems, because when you deploy one of the two applications, it uses the new protocol, and the old, not deployed yet, recipient of the message will start to fail. So if you have A and B, two services, and you want to rename a field in the communication protocol, what do you do? You start by deploying an intermediate version of A that uses the same value for that field with the old and the new name. Renaming a field is a pretty common case. Then you deploy a new final version of B that uses the new name of the field. And then you deploy the final version of A that passes only that field, the new name of the field, throwing away the backward compatibility. This is just what library maintainers do when they release open source software. When you have to rename a method, you cannot just rename it and throw it at your users so that when they do Composer update, they get a broken version of their application that was relying on you. So what do? You add a new version of the method, you stay for a while with both names, both signatures, so that users can adapt. And after a while, you deprecate and then remove the old methods. This is the same way, but you are both the open source library maintainer and the user of the platform. Backward compatibility is, again, a problem for which we have many solutions. However, there are, as I said, as I listed before, more difficult problems, like that of latency. For performing a payment on your principal service, that service has to make 100 calls to the backend service for reporting, then it's going to be very slow, because each HTTP request has a setup time, there is a latency to arriving to the other machine and coming back. If you are able to do less requests, you are inherently faster. There is a kind of architecture coming from the SQRS background, common query responsibility segregation, and in any case popular in the domain-driven design world, that more or less goes like this. You have your single service, and this service is built by receiving commands. These commands are things that he has to do, like billing a user for 10 euros. These commands may have or not have a synchronous response, but it must be based only on the database of this particular service. You perform this command by making some change to the state of the database of this particular service that you're working on in this moment, and then you publish domain events, which is a fancy way of saying you send messages to other services that need to integrate with you. For example, you have changed the password of a user, you send an event password changed containing this new data, so that other services can subscribe to these events and integrate with you. The important part is that, however, you do not make these calls in the middle of your business logic inside that particular service, but you list up all the events that you have to emit, and when you're finished with your work, you have committed your transaction to the local database, you can then send these events to the listeners, which are other services usually. You can even send these domain events outside of the process that serves the user. So the client may be a JavaScript application, and once the state is committed, that commit state, the database has been finished, you can immediately return to the user and make these domain events go toward other services, even in other PHP processes which are not the ones in Apache that serve the user. However, I don't hide that this is a more difficult way to model your business logic. In a sense, you're moving your domain model from the metaphor of making phone calls to other applications to instead being able of just sending emails. So you may have to change a lot of how your objects interact if you want to isolate essentially all the calls in that final phase, sending domain events asynchronously to other services. But the nice thing about this architecture, if you reach a state in which you only communicate with external services by these domain events, is that it is also able to solve another problem, which is that of failure. When you distribute between different machines, there are a whole bunch of things that can go wrong, and there are many more with respect to the things that can go wrong on a single machine. When you have a single PHP process, you call a method, and what may happen? It throws an exception. It writes some warnings to the error log. These are mostly the things that can happen locally. When you call other machines, it becomes more complicated. For example, the method can hang indefinitely because you have not set up timeouts correctly. The host of the other application may not respond because the DNS has some problems. The application may respond, but very slowly. So you need a way to cut it out. The application may be giving you 500 HTTP status codes, and you don't know if the work has been performed or not on the other side. There are a whole bunch of things that can go wrong. But if you model your application in this way, by having domain events going between services as the only way of communication, then what do you do when you encounter a failure? You embrace the style of the postman, and you just retry. What do you do if you don't get an answer to an email? You send another email, pushing the person, hopefully not so much, since it can be arrogant, but if you don't get an answer to an email, you can send another one. If the recipient is an automated system, you will not hurt his feelings, so you can send many, many replies. And what we can do with HTTP is model our domain events that describe a change that has happened to a service, and they want to bring it to another service. These calls model a single one of these domain events, they model it as a message, so they don't expect a particular response code or response body. And basically, we move our infrastructure from making phone calls to sending mails. So instead of making an HTTP application, and expecting a particular response body, we do something else that I'll show you in a minute. So let's say you have jumped on this bandwagon, I want to do microservices, and you have to make these A and B services communicate. A is your payment system. The user is using that to perform a billing, 10 euros to buy some credits on an external website. And B instead is your panel that is showing all the transactions for the day. You don't want the user being interrupted in his payment just because the panel is down. The panel just has to come up again after a while and register this billing so that it can show in the nice statistics to the other people in your office. So between A and B, you can send asynchronous messages with HTTP in this way. You build up a request. This request has an URL, a body, possibly containing the domain event. We use JSON as a serialization format, but you can use XML, it's the same, plain text, CSV, it's the same. It has some authentication, and you store this request as a job to be executed by a worker system inside the service A. You can use German for that, you can use Q systems. We build a simple job system over MongoDB that pulls a collection for jobs to do, and there are these long-running PHP processes that run on the same machine as Apache, and they pull this database for jobs to execute periodically. So when I say as job, instead of executing this request immediately, this infrastructure stores that in a MongoDB collection so that long-running processes outside of Apache can take it out and execute it. Since if there is a problem, I want this request to be retried until my panel comes up again, I attach to the document stored inside the database also a success specification. In this case, the ensure is telling the workers to expect a 200 or 509 HTTP status code. In case there is another status code, like 500, in case there is a timeout, in case the other application has a NOST which is not resolving at any time, in case of any error, the request will be retried until these particular status codes are returned by the string application. So if my panel is down, I can continue to use one bit to pay for something, and when the panel comes up, all these events are delivered to it. So we are essentially freeing B from the responsibility of having to be up and running for all the availability that we want to guarantee in our applications. The payment service must be online 99.99999% of the day, because otherwise we lose money. But the panel can be dropped down for 1 hour for maintenance, who cares? When it comes up again, we will bring the events to it and it will update its own database. There are several things to discuss, some aspects that came up when you use HTTP in this way. One is that of messaging semantics. When you send an event this way with HTTP, you can never do anything in your code with the result of an external call. your send request method, instead of returning a response object, becomes void. Because what to do if it fails? If the request succeeds, okay, I have a response to give to you and you can execute something. But if it fails and they have to retry after a while, what can I give you as an answer? Nothing. I don't know. I don't even know if the other application has already received the request or if I didn't even reach it. So I send request with void method and not with at return response in our documentation. Another aspect is that of identicals, which is not a medical condition, like many papers say, but instead is means that when a request is received by a service, the same request being received multiple times should not lead to a different result. There are scenarios where this comes up, which is, for example, I send one of these requests and I get a timeout. There are two possible things that has happened in this case. The other application did not receive the request at all, so it didn't do anything. DNS not resolved, for example. Or the other application may have received the request, but the connection has been cut. It happens on the cloud. And I did not receive the response instead. I do not know if the request has already been processed or not. So what can I do? I can only retry. And in order to be able to retry, the request must be identical. So when it did not arrive and I retry, I will get a 200 response code, very well. Instead, when it succeeded, and I got the timeout, we get the 409 conflict. I have already dealt with this request, but in any case, I can retry and retry and retry until I get a response without a billing, for example, being registered multiple times in my panel. The panel must guarantee the idempotence of the request describing the billing that it receives, so that if I mail it multiple times because the connection breaks, still I have each billing once and only once in my panel. Another final aspect is that of the retry policy. When you start retrying these requests, you go from the simpler way, just not retry, but be vulnerable to these network errors, to retrying once, which is the most difficult step, because you need to set up workers being able to pick up the failed request and to mail them again to our services. Then you can go many different ways. You can retry many times, spaced 60 seconds between each try. You can do exponential backlog, which instead you distanciate the attempts starting from 10 seconds and then retrying every 10, 20, 30 seconds and so on. The other aspect is the persistence of the requests. You heard benchmarks about the system that say we deliver 4 million messages every minute. But if they do it in memory, it's very risky because if you restart them, you lose all the messages that we are going to integrate with our services. So basically, using HTTP as a message bus is possible. You can decouple PHP application, making them collaborate with this protocol without tying them to be all up and running and fast at the same time. If you want to reduce latency, yeah, you need, in fact, a messaging architecture. You need to start thinking about sending mails between services and not making phone calls. And you need a job system that can deal with this failure of delivering mails and retry delivering them after a while. Basically, what we say in these cases is you need to start thinking of your services as doing some local changes, producing events, producing mails, and sending to someone else, which is a much higher decoupling than making synchronous calls. If you're interested in these things, I've had some links in this slide that I will share on Twitter right now. It is distributed systems are a complex field, but if you want to improve our applications and be ready for the future, we need to go beyond the single monolith. So, thanks for your attention, and we do not have time for questions inside here because our time is up, but I will be outside, so feel free to ask me anything after. after I free the space for the next one. Thanks.